Good morning, everybody. Happy Friday. We have an amazing show for everybody today. And we've got the great Ryan Grimm. He's in for Crystal Ball. It's great to see you, Ryan. How are you, my friend?
It's been an amazing week. I know people are looking forward to seeing Crystal next week, but I've had an amazing time with you,
yeah,
Saagar.
Well, we always have a good time, don't we, Ryan? We've got Rachel Bovard in the show today. She's going to be talking about Section 230, the president's threat in order to veto the National Defense Authorization Bill on that. That's an interesting one. We talk about tech here a lot. And we've got the great David Sirota. Him and I are going to be talking about HHS, the Health and Human Services nominee, and potentially some big problems over who is going to get that job. And David, as always, you know, has an encyclopedic knowledge of corruption and of people's ties to these bad groups. So we're going to be hearing a lot about that. But I want to pick up on a story that we talked about yesterday, because this could have very profound electoral implications. And we played for you yesterday that clip of Lynn Wood and Sidney Powell. Lynn Wood is an attorney down there working on Trump's behalf. Sidney Powell, I mean, is an attorney, apparently not for Trump, don't really know who for, who's been behind a lot of these Dominion voting things. Well, their calls in that video that we played yesterday, in order to just not vote in Georgia, telling Republicans explicitly don't vote for Kelly Loeffler, David Perdue, or whomever until this voter fraud stuff is under control. Well, a lot of Republicans in Washington are beginning to realize this could be a big, big problem. And it started out with something I mentioned, Newt Gingrich. Let's throw this up there on the screen. Newt Gingrich immediately tweeted yesterday morning. He said, Lynn Wood and Sidney Powell are totally destructive, telling everybody to make sure that they go out and vote in the Georgia elections. But what really caught my eye, Ryan, is this next one. Let's throw this up there, which is that the Trump campaign, the Trump war room, tweeting, quote, records, Lynn Wood has decades voted for donated to Democrats, including Barack Obama and David Perdue's 2014 opponent. So when the Trump campaign itself is now attacking Lynn Wood, it's a very tough situation, Ryan, because the president, obviously, I guarantee you, you know, loves Lynn Wood and loves, like, whatever he said. But the professional GOP apparatus is like, what the hell do we do here? We got to put this cat back in the bag somehow.
Yes. No, that's a good analogy, because this it's ever try to get a cat back into a bag. I mean, that's why that saying works. It's impossible. Or you can talk about the horse being out of the barn, or you can talk about, you know, the way that Saudi Arabia thought that it would solve some of its domestic issues by funding extremist networks around the globe, and then they came back and attacked the Saudi regime. Or you can think about the Republican Party back in 2009, mm-hmm. thinking that the Tea Party was going to be a great thing that they could stoke to take the majority. That was Boehner's big idea, and end up with them, ousting Boehner. So, these things are difficult to control. And so now you have Trump probably, enjoying all of this. And you have Lynn Wood, who is a rock ribbed Republican. I mean, this is the Republican attorney who every campaign would and every kind of powerful figure would turn to for libel help. I mean, I know that 8 years ago he threatened to sue me and the Huffington Post over a story that we were working on. He's like the go-to guy for those fights that Republicans have with the media. Like any big shot, he's gonna dole out contributions to both
everybody.
Parties.
Yeah.
I mean, But he's given an extraordinary amount to Republicans, including to David Perdue. Wildly, he said on Twitter last night that Perdue had solicited a $25,000 contribution and that he felt like he had given it. Now, we'd have to know a lot more details about that solicitation.
Yeah, but
that runs up against the federal maximum, which is $5,600. You can give more than that. Maybe there was some joint fundraising committee, it was a super PAC, but technically and legally, candidates are not supposed to ask for more than $5,600. You're supposed to wink and nod. We know that Perdue likes to brush up against all kinds of ethical lines when it comes to his stock trading. So, it's hilarious that Lynn Wood might have outed him in some type of FEC
campaign
violation.
Finance problem. That's so funny. And as I predicted, Ryan, I was just looking for the story. Trump called Lynn Wood this week. I knew he would. He can't he has to call and keep in people close who are, you know, seen to be defending him in this way. And the professional GOP really has no idea what to do. I saw my old colleagues over at the Daily Caller reporting this. They're also trying to push this stuff about Lynn Wood. Let's throw that tear sheet up there. Lynn Wood hasn't voted Republican since 2004, at least in a Republican primary, the Secretary of State's office confirms. I mean, it's funny here because people are trying to paint this as like, oh, he's a disloyal traitor and all of that. And I'm like, guys, you know, like Trump voted Democrat many times. Like he was like he donated to like Hillary Clinton, you know, like not that long ago. And it's I think it's fine. You know, people change their minds, like whatever. You don't have to be a loyal one. But this just goes to show that the GOP, by elevating Sidney Powell, especially, I mean, remember that tweet, the professional account of the entire Republican Party put out her Kraken press conference or whatever, and literally the next day, she's disavowed by Trump. Lynn Wood, like you said, the same thing. Look, everybody in Washington knows Lynn Wood has been on the side. Didn't he represent, like, Nicholas Sandman or something like that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so there you go. I mean, he was like an icon not even that long ago.
He's currently representing Kyle Rittenhouse.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's not exactly a cause celeb on the left.
Yeah. Right. Exactly. And so, like, this is a well-known, you know, kind of GOP legal defender. And again, it's all good. The problem is that now they don't know what to do with him. And I can see this generally in the way that this might be hurting the chances in Georgia. And it's like a really fascinating problem that they have. And especially, I think Hannity kind of embodies this, where he's been pushing this stuff probably harder than anybody else that is on Fox. Tucker's moved on. Laura Ingraham has moved on. The rest of the day side, obviously, has completely moved on. He's really been, you know, just indulging a lot of this stuff. And I got to wonder at what point that you're going to have the same thing that happened with Rachel Maddow, where she lost 500,000 viewers in like a single week when the Mueller report came out. And they're like, hey, a lot of what you've been telling us is total bullshit. And I saw that this happened last night with Sean Hannity when he's talking to Rudy Giuliani. Let's take a listen.
I'm watching all of this very close. I watched Georgia today very closely, this video. Then we got the case
Georgia
in Wisconsin. And then we got the case in Nevada. And then if the Supreme Court ever takes the constitutional arguments of Pennsylvania, we have a real constitutional shot, in my opinion. You go wherever you.
Oh, we have a real good shot. I mean, today's video was really explosive.
Right. I mean, you can see there, Ryan. They're giving their viewers hope, and like that is just not responsible. Number one, but number two, it could have a very dramatic effect. We saw this actually. Remember at Fox, the whole unskew the polls movement back in like 2012. Mm-hmm. That really affected their ratings, and I actually think you can track that with also voter performance. And if 80% of people who voted for Trump think that the election was fraudulent, and as we played that clip with this on Monday of the GOP chairwoman getting shouted down by GOP voters saying, hey, if the election is rigged, they have a really big problem, I think, in this upcoming runoff.
Yeah, there's a real impulsivity to it that isn't connected to any thought process of how this plays out. You know, at the very beginning, the idea was, let's make this loss look less bad, and let's keep you know, the Trump only supporters engaged by talking about the rigging of this election, and by so doing, and by keeping them engaged, you increase your chances of them still being engaged in January when the next runoff comes along. You know, that was what passed for a plan here, but there was no step in the middle that said, okay, well, what are you going to do when your claims that the republic is being overthrown,
right,
can't be borne out by forget arguments like even any significant evidence? And the courts, you know, in unanimous fashion, keep tossing out these lawsuits saying, you haven't presented any evidence. You need actual evidence of votes that were fraudulent for us to consider this case. You need that in court, but you don't necessarily need that in the court of Facebook. You know, you can uh-huh. keep the memes going, and you can keep millions of people fired up just with little snippets of video. There was one going around yesterday of some counting that went on in Michigan for about an hour after GOP election observers had gone home, and people were like, this is it. know, this is the Zapruder film. Like, we've cracked this case. Like, Trump is the president. Biden should concede. This is over. And it shows how low the bar has gotten for what could constitute evidence to this audience that is so fired up and is so convinced. And, you know, for people like Lynn Wood and Sidney Powell, who are taking this seriously, and Lou Dobbs is another one, it makes a lot of sense.
Oh, they'll be fine. Yeah, they're going to write a book about the plot to steal the election or something. They'll make millions of dollars. Right. Yeah, we know that. Yeah.
Right. Right. And and for the millions of people that believe it, they believe that this is the end of American democracy as they know it. Like, they're taking this stuff very seriously, that they believe that Hugo Chavez's conspiracy with Dominion actually moved votes, and that you're going to have a usurper in the White House. And, you know, that gets people, you know, fired up. What could be more serious than the end of the republic?
Yeah, I know. And, you know, this is what we said about Russiagate. This is what you got to say about this, too. And I think it's incredibly irresponsible. And there's a lot of people out there who put a lot of faith in Donald Trump because he said things that nobody else would. And he spoke truths that nobody else would. They really believe in him. And, you know, that's a very powerful thing. And with that comes a lot of responsibility. And you can see now, Sidney Powell and all this, it can come back to dramatically backfire. I would be remiss, too, if I didn't mention, it's not just like Trump supporters who may not come out and vote. There was a large population of people who voted for David Perdue, Kelly Loeffler, and then didn't vote for Trump, I guess because they were turned off by him. But Trump, by using his force of personality and forcing Perdue and Loeffler to like go along with a lot of this stuff, he could turn them off too. So it's get like the worst of all worlds, right? Like, you get neither of the Trump supporters, and you don't get these suburban Republicans, and you could lose. It's very likely.
Yeah. No, he massively underperformed both Perdue and Loeffler. It's right. It's quite remarkable. And in that situation, you would think that those Senate candidates then have some power in the relationship. You have a defeated president who underperformed the local candidates, and yet the local candidates are the one genuflecting to the one who underperformed them. And, you know, he's coming down Saturday. Rudy's there now. He's coming down Saturday for a rally, and Republicans down there panicked that he's going to send this even further around the bend than it already is by going off script at the rally.
No, I think that's right. And I think it's going to be a big, big problem for the GOP in this race. We're going to continue in order to track this. Coming up, friend of the show, David Sirota. He's going to discuss the details developing around Biden's HHS picks. That's when Rising continues.